while they're fiddling with the AV. But you know, I wanted to give the sort of main inspiration, at least. So for last time, I mentioned it, but I never wrote it down. A paper by Polishuk called K-Theoretic Exceptional Collections at Roots of Unity. And for today's lecture, you know, a paper by Futaki and Ueda called Tropical Coamoeba and Torus Equivariant Homological Neurosymmetry for Projective Space. So the main lesson to learn from this is that I think both of these papers have a very small readership. And the main thing is that you have to be careful about choosing the titles of your papers. So I think if Polishuk had called it, you know, congruences for ranks of exceptional vector bundles, everybody would have said, go. Right? Similarly speaking, this is actually two papers in one. And the tropical coamoeba part comes actually later. And I think if they had just split it into two and called it homological mirror symmetry for projective space, you know, it would have had a lot more impact. But so I'm giving these people their credit. Okay, so let me. So I want to start with something, you know, very simple. So we have E is a Kähler manifold. Okay, and pi, or sometimes people like to call it W, is a holomorphic function. So in this situation, we have you know, we have a preferred connection on this map here, so obviously away from critical points. Okay. So a connection means that I have a splitting of this guy here into its vertical part and a necessarily one-dimensional thing, a complex one-dimensional thing, which is actually generated by So the gradient is, you know, the complex conjugate of the complex derivative with respect to the metric, okay? So as you can see, this is, you know, fails to be defined if we were at a critical point, okay? So parallel transport if it exists, if it's well defined, I have to integrate the connection is a symplectic, so which means it preserves the K form isomorphism between different fibers. Okay. So why? Well, so in the simplest formulation instance, you can say the following thing, something that's not quite that vector field, so you right, so I normalize that vector field such that it maps to 1 on the base. If you don't normalize, so the gradient flow of the real part of pi, a gradient vector field. Say, let's treat this as a real function. It's also the Hamiltonian vector field vector field of, I guess, generic Parton pi. Okay? So you're in a slightly bizarre situation where you have a flow that's simultaneously a gradient flow and a symplectic Hamiltonian flow. And those things usually tend to contradict each other, right? The gradient flow sort of contracts. The Hamiltonian flow is volume preserving. And I will always assume that parallel transport here is well defined, that you can integrate those vector fields. You know, it's your job in any case to figure out you know, why you want to do it. Obviously, if it's proper, you can always integrate it. I mean, any singularities, if you're using that one here and this one here, you can integrate, but mostly it will be non-proper, and I'll just ignore this question. Okay? So, this is pi, sorry, I should get a dimension, each of those. Okay, so suppose here you have a non-degenerate critical point. Okay, so here's its critical value. Now, Columbia has wonderful colored chalk. So I go in positive real direction from here, and I look at everything that flows, well, asymptotically in time backwards into this critical point, or out of this critical point here. Okay, so these things here are called Lefschetz thimbles. Okay, now. So this is a diffeomorphic to Rn, where n is the complex dimension of E, simply because, well, this has non-degenerate critical points, so it means the Hessian is non-degenerate. So if you look at the Hessian of the real part, it always has half of the Morse index. And so this is the usual thing for a gradient flow. So let's call it, okay? So this is Rn, and it's Lagrangian. So it's a half-dimensional manifold, real manifold, on which the Kähler form vanishes. And the reason the Kähler form vanishes is very familiar, right? So the flow is a Hamiltonian flow. So therefore, it preserves, if I take two tangent vectors, you know, the evaluation of the Kähler form on those two tangent vectors is preserved. But on the other hand, the two tangent vectors shrink as you approach the critical point, and therefore the number must have been zero all the time. Okay? So slightly more generally. For any path, okay, so I look at this guy here. This is the base C, and I assume have critical values for assuming that all the critical points are non-degenerate. I don't have to go in positive real direction. I can go like this, and let's make the assumption that after a while I always go here horizontally to the right. We get a properly embedded Lefschetz thimble. Okay. So we're interested in the topology and symplectic topology of those thimbles. You know, if you want to ever pay tribute, Lefschetz is buried in Princeton Cemetery. So when you go out to Princeton, you can go, you know, give him thanks for giving us all employment. So let me ask you, let me tell you, so, and as far as I know, this is kind of shocking, but Okay, so suppose that pi has only non-degenerate critical points. Okay. So take a properly embedded Lagrange submanifold. L in E, L is like Rn, which outside a compact subset fibers over a path. So I don't know what it does here, right? Let me use another color. So it's some sort of shapeless blob here, I don't know. And then, okay, then it does this thing. And I should, by the way, I forgot to say something. Talked about this too many times. So, in the fibers, we have so, you know, the fact that it's fibered over a path, so, you know, you have this thing here, there are spheres, and it's, you know, there's a sphere of every point on this path, we have Lagrangian spheres, and those are called vanishing circles. Okay, so they sit inside some fiber that lies on this path here. Okay? And so the condition that I put there, that it should be fibered over a path, also means that, you know, there have to be some kind of closed Lagrangian submanifolds in the fibers here, that it's fibered over. So, okay, so it's fibered over a path, but here I don't care. Okay? Then, is it a Lefschetz thing?
Get any indication from the mirror sign?
Okay, let me stay at a fairly. So, does anybody know any counterexample to this? Okay. This is, I think, is a dramatic situation here. You know, you get the definite feeling that the answer should be no, because you should be able to make up more stuff. It's supposed to be Rn.
Oh, I missed the
R. Supposed to be Rn, right? If you ask for arbitrary topology, then there is no problem, I think. Right? I mean, there are things, yes. So the part of the reason why I think the answer should be no is because, you know, the conjecture seems to be put out of several different pieces. It behaves as infinity like this. It's Rn, and the pieces don't seem to individually glue together very well, right? But the problem is, obviously, there are a lot of paths. There are a lot of vanishing cycles. So you have to show that this is not the vanishing cycle. Well, OK. Up to isotopy in a suitable sense, right?
You mean a Lefschetz symbol for this?
For this particular vibration.
You can't change the vibration. No,
for this vibration, that's what I'm asking, okay? But otherwise the question doesn't make sense for this function. Because, you know, the question of going to infinity depends on your choice of function, right? So, yeah. So, you know, well, you know, there are other. There are other constructions of Lagrangian submanifolds, for instance, as real locus of real points in a complex manifold, that have nothing to do with vanishing cycles, right? And so your first attempt might be to say, well, I take one of those. I was not successful. Let me. So the question is, how hard would you have to work to construct one of such things, which is not a vanishing cycles? And there's actually plenty of space for finding a solution which is completely elementary, doesn't use more than basic algebra topology. Okay, but in order to explain this to you, I have to, do some homology theory. Okay, so. So I want to see, look at the middle dimensional homology of E relative to what I call this, the fibrate infinity, which simply means the locus of points where the real part of pi is very, very large. Okay? Because I'm assuming that we have parallel transport, you just have to assume that your bound is larger than all the critical values, and then it won't matter which bound that is. Okay? So this carries a non-symmetric intersection form. Okay, which is so why is it not symmetric? Well, let me look at two cycles. So suppose I have something like this. This is projection to the base. Okay. So this is a cycle. Let's call it D2. And here's another cycle. Let's call it D1. Okay, so a priori they're disjoint, but what happens is when you form the intersection pairing, you sort of, you move this guy here. Okay, and the definition is that this guy here, which I will call like this, okay, is actually intersect D2. Okay. If you find this terribly vague, you just say like this, well, you know that there's actually not was just one such group, but there is one such group for every direction of going to infinity. Okay? So this is real goes to infinity, but I could also bend it in any way. And if you have two different ways to go to infinity, then clearly there's an intersection pairing between those two groups. So you take two elements of this group, you move the first element into the group which has a slightly bigger slope, and then you intersect. And that's why it's unsymmetric, because there's a preferred direction here. Okay? And so okay, so every Lefschetz symbol has a class. That's what this group is for. It's in this guy here. And if you look at this guy, this self-intersection is always equal to plus one. Okay? Note notation of complex manifolds. To be defined accordingly. Defined in a suitable way. Okay, so if you use the standard way of choosing orientation of a complex manifold, there's not a one here, there's a dimension dependent constant, but I find one more comforting. Okay? So the reason is that when you have a complex manifold, your basis for the orientation is real part, imaginary part. But if you're a symplectic geometer, you do real part, imaginary part, and that leads to this one here. Okay? So very good. So in fact, write this down, but in the case where there are only non-degenerate critical points, that here free abelian one generator for each point, and you just need to take a bunch of Lefschetz symbols, one for each critical point, chosen arbitrarily. Now there are a lot of symbols because there are a lot of paths that you can draw going from a critical point to infinity. Right? I noticed that, you know, maybe I wasn't quite sure, but quite clear about this, but when you draw the path that goes to infinity, you start at a critical point, and you have to avoid all other critical points. Right? And it's the same thing for isotopes. You can deform the path, but you can't pass over critical points. So there are a lot of choices. Okay? So okay, so if I have two paths, now I'm going to draw them for simplicity like this, okay, and I have two Lefschetz symbols, there's one thing that I can do, which is I can sort of almost go to infinity, and then I go back. So these two paths are supposed to be like this, so they're disjoint, and this one here goes to infinity at a lower height than that one there. So I go almost to infinity, then I go back, I go around all the other path, and that's independent of what other critical points you might have. Okay, and then I go there. Okay. Let's call this one here, I did the wrong thing, R delta 2 delta 1, that's a new Lefschetz symbol, and there's the corresponding thing in the other direction. So these are still delta 1, delta 2. These are L delta 1, delta 2. Okay. And so there's a formula for the homology classes in this group here, which is so the class of L delta 1, delta 2. I mean, it does look vaguely like delta 1. And then it's a minus delta 1, delta 2. Whoops. This does look vaguely like delta 1 minus delta 1, delta 2. I messed up. Excuse me. Yeah. No, minus delta 1, delta 2. Da, 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 da. Excuse me. Minus delta 1. There you go. And R. That makes sense because, you know, this pairing here of delta 1 and delta 2 will be non-zero because you move this up here. And the same thing here, R delta 2 delta 1 is the other formula. Minus okay, and if you remember the formula for mutation of exceptional bundles from the last time, you'll notice a striking parallelism. Okay, so now, let's suppose that we start with a basis of Lefschetz symbols. Basis, here we are. So I assume here I have three critical points, and I draw a collection of three paths, arbitrarily. So let's say this is delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. Then this group here is generated by these three classes. And all Lefschetz symbols can be obtained from these by ln R operations. Okay. So you start with those, and you can sort of do this ln R, you get new, and you iterate, and you can get any Lefschetz symbol for any path. That's because essentially it is a braid group problem. Okay? So any, you know, you can put any given thimble into one such basis. And you know, two bases differ by a diffeomorphism of the plane that keeps the critical points. And so these moves here actually correspond to generators of the braid group and inverses. Yes?
Are you asserting that if the function has exactly n non-degenerate critical points and no others, that the this relative homology group
that's right.
is generated by thimbles emanating in the same direction?
Yeah. And it's, in fact, it has free of rank n.
All thimbles are obtained by this mutation.
All thimbles are obtained by this mutation starting from a basis here, right? But that's just for thimbles. It's essentially a question about paths, right? Okay. So now I will tell you how to use this to attack our conjecture. So assume that. Okay. So for the initial basis, by the way. For a basis, which is defined like this, okay, so if you look at the this form here, okay, you have a Lefschetz thimble with itself, it's always 1, and it's actually 0 if I is bigger than j. If you look at the pairing between this and this, you're supposed to take this guy, these are disjoint, obviously, you take this guy, you bend it up, and it's still disjoint. Okay, so the interesting ones are the other ones. Okay? So this pairing is always non-degenerate. It has this upper triangular form. So assume that for some p, we have this guy here congruent to 0 mod p for I. Okay. Then any vanishing cycle, any Lefschetz symbol, satisfies so it's mod p class. It's always one of those delta. Well, let's look at the formula here. Right? So, well, if you look at mod p, if you assume, make this assumption here, right? So the you know, the situation where you do operation here, sort of, it's an iterative process. So if you do the, you know, if you start with this basis here, and you do these changes for the first time, you'll get this guy here 0 mod p, or this guy here 0 mod p, and that essentially, that continues to be the case. Okay? So, you know, you have this unsymmetric quadratic form of rank n over z mod p, and there are lots of classes which have self-pairing 1. But there's a restriction in this case here on the classes that can be realized by Lefschetz symbols. And therefore, if you want to prove the conjecture, all you've got to do is you've got to find one Lagrangian submanifold with the right properties whose homology class is not one of those. Okay? So this is under this assumption here. Right? Well, this is a rather specific assumption, but you know, there are, you know, you could do two and maybe find a couple of examples, right? So, so in spite of that, I completely failed to... What's that? Yes?
So in real dimension 4, there's this Ochsenbrock-Polterovich theorem, which says that like a Lagrangian which looks standard at infinity has to be standard, is that not?
Well, but that's correct. But that's the case of C2 with a function that has no critical point whatsoever. Has one critical point, one quadratic critical point. Yeah, so in that case, it is true, right?
You would need to have it look standard at infinity, but so I guess you don't know what that.
No. I mean, this applies to C2 and to Lagrangian submanifolds, which are a flat plane at infinity, which corresponds to the case of the function x squared plus one. Yeah, so in that case, we actually know it. That's correct, but there's a vast amount of room. I'm not asking for you to really prove this up to isotropy. It could be that it's really wrong on a basic topological homology class level, right? So this is not somewhere where I'm aiming subtleties. Okay, very good. So I like examples, right? So let's look at an example in some length. Okay. So the example that I want to look at is where the manifold is a complex torus. And the function is this Laurent polynomial here. Okay? It's about the simplest Laurent polynomial that I can write down that actually has critical points. If I leave out this term here, then there are obviously no critical points, and similar if I leave out any of the other terms. Okay? So so this has n plus 1 critical points. Which are when these guys here are all equal and are equal to an n plus first root of unity. The critical values, they are non-degenerate. And their critical values are. Well, they are obviously n plus 1 times root n 1. Okay? So let's choose a basis of Lefschetz symbols. Okay, you'll have to give me a moment. Okay, so let's suppose n is 2, for instance. So, well, let's suppose something slightly bigger. In an attempt to impress you more, okay? So these are the five. This is the base C. And what to do is I'm going to go inwards from all of them and then bend it out. Okay. Yeah. So these are delta 1 up to, well, generally speaking, it's delta n plus 1. Okay? And then, in this case, okay, the interesting intersection numbers are these guys here. In particular, if n plus 1 is a prime power, then these are here congruent to 0 mod p, well, for I less than j. Isn't that nice? Okay, so this would be a prime example in which to use our strategy here to do something. I said, you know, you can get examples. This is a good example. You can, even if you're willing to make the dimension rather large, you can get some really chunky piece. So you have a lot of space in the mod p homology to find other things. So let me work. Okay, so for pi, if d Rn isomorphic to D is embedded in E, is a Lagrangian with the correct behavior at infinity. I'm not going to write. So which means it goes to infinity in the way that you want it to, over some path. Then D is, n plus 1 is p to the nu. Then D is congruent to plus minus delta I in Hn e plus infinity tensor z mod p. Okay? So it can't be done. Okay? So in this case here, out of all the Lagrangian submanifolds, they completely fail to fill out the space of homology classes that they could have. Always okay for some I. Okay? So I'm not really sure whether, you know. Okay, I didn't investigate the question of exactly which classes you can get by L and R behavior beyond this one here. Okay? But yeah, so you can't do it. So this is not easy. Okay? So there are, you know, there are known restrictions on the topology of Lagrangian submanifolds. This is not a restriction of that kind. It's a much more sophisticated thing. In fact, what happens is that, so this uses homological mirror symmetry. And one, the whole thing. Okay, you'd notice some similarities, right? So, this example here is known as the mirror projective space, and indeed, if you had a Lagrangian submanifold symmetry to translate it into, well, not quite an exceptional vector bundle on projective space, but some object of the derived category, and then we use the whole thing from the lecture. So this guy here is translated into K theory, and we use the theorem, Polyshuk's theorem from the previous lecture to derive this restriction. And Polyshuk's theorem used some sort of symmetry. I mean, I used the full special linear group acting on projective space. You can actually get away with slightly less than that. But it certainly uses symmetries that are not a priori evident in the problem as given. Okay? So, you know, what does this say for the general conjecture? Well, it says almost nothing because this is a very special case. It's just there's these classes of very well-known special cases, and so when you try to disprove the conjecture, you would say, okay, why don't I grab some case where we sort of really understand the vanishing cycles already, and I just need to do a little bit of computation. But the problem is those cases that we understand very well tend to have their own special structures. Okay? I'm going to explain to you more about how this is proved, because, you know, if you're into homological mirror symmetry, you know exactly what I'm going to do, and if not, it's going to be too long. But I do want to explain, which will be actually the main ingredient anyway, this formula here. Okay, so I just wrote it on the board. Well, it's some kind of intersection of cycles in some n-dimensional complex manifold, but the question is, you know, how did I come up with this? Okay. I'm not going to give you the full proof of this, but I'll give you an impression of how it's done because it's nice. Yes.
So yes. Do you know a category with an exceptional collection in which there is an exceptional object that is not extended?
That's right, so we don't. Or at least I don't, but, you know, call Moscow for assistance. Okay? Right, so there's a question about whether I could use mirror symmetry to find a counterexample. To suggest a counterexample. But, you know, that's because, you know, in algebraic geometry, it's really hard to come up with an object, right? You know, I mean, yes, if it's a line bundle, you could say, but that question has been very, very extensively studied, you know. How do I fit various line bundles into the picture of exceptional objects? Well, of course, in projective space, it's no problem. But otherwise, it's hard. But you know, in geometry, we have all these things. We could, you know, do some topology. We could glue some stuff in, and so on. It seems to me that, you know, imagination is more readily available here on this side. Right? Are there more questions? Okay, let's do it. Okay, so this is sort of a tribute to Lefschetz, I would say. Okay. So I want to look at this thing here. Okay, so let's look at our example. I'm not going to do it well. Okay. Okay. I could start with the case n equals 1, but I think it's too low dimensional, so we just get confused. So for n equals to 2, so we're looking at pi of z equals z1 plus z2 plus 1 over z1, z2. Okay? So this is from E, which is c star squared. So we, so the Lefschetz thimbles are, so R2's embedded in E, and the vanishing cycles are, you know, well, there's deltas, so these are V's. These are S1s that are embedded in some fiber. This is slightly nicer because the fiber is a Riemann surface, and we're just talking about curves on the Riemann surface, okay? So note that for a basis, right? So if I wanted to compute these guys here, okay, so there's cases which are obvious. I don't have to think about it. Okay, that's always the case. And in the other situation, which is interesting one, right? I have these guys here. I bend it this way. And you'll notice that after I bend it, these two paths will intersect exactly once, okay? And so whatever intersection there is between that guy and this guy happens in a single fiber, which is where the vanishing cycles intersect. Okay, so this guy here. So this is the intersection of vanishing cycles. And that happens inside a fiber. Okay. So I reduced it to one dimension down. So sorry, I don't want to call it E sub Z because Z are the variables of the total space. Let me call it sigma. Okay, there you go. So, okay. So let's look at the fiber. For instance, the fiber at zero. Okay, so now this is some kind of Riemann surface. Well, what kind of Riemann surface is this? Well, let's look, for instance, that I just projected onto one variable. Okay, so this. So if you fix this variable here, these are just become constants, and this is essentially a quadratic equation after multiplying by z1. So this is a 2-to-1 cover with 3 branch points. Okay. So, this is the Z2 plane. Remember, Z2 has to be non-zero. And there are 3 branch points right here. Okay? And if I'm interested in a vanishing cycle, so a vanishing cycle lies in this fiber here. In this case here, I chose the fiber over 0. Conveniently, because all our paths sort of go together at zero, and then go off to infinity. So there's this 2-to-1 cover Riemann surface, which you'll easily compute to be a 3 puncture torus. And on that 2-to-1 cover, there is somewhere there is this vanishing cycle. Okay. So the question is, where is it? Well, in fact, there's 3 different vanishing cycles. Okay. So the point is this. You think about the definition of Lefschetz thimble, right? So you have such a path. Over each point here, there is a vanishing cycle. Okay. But it's hard to see because the vanishing cycle is defined by parallel transport all the way back here. Okay, so by solving some ODE. But if you place yourself very close to here, then the vanishing cycle has almost collapsed to a point. And then you can see it. Okay? So. Okay, so similarly, if you take some other fiber and I do the same trick, so it's some constant C. C2 is a 2-to-1 with C-dependent branch points. Okay. So this was the situation. Sorry. For C equals 0. So what happens is now you fire up Mathematica, and you see where the branch points moves depending on C. Let me suppose that I do C is approximately 3. Okay. Remember the critical values were 3 times the third unity. Okay. And so what happens is that, well, it looks roughly like this. And what happens in time is that that guy moves here, and this guy here moves here. Okay? So where is the vanishing cycle, right? So if you actually go to C equals three, these two branch points will come together, and that's where the singularity is. So the vanishing cycle has to be somewhere close to here, right? And so in fact, if I draw this unique short path here, right, it's a 2-to-1 cover. So over this path, there are two paths which join together at the endpoints, which is a circle, and that's the vanishing cycle. Okay, so vanishing cycle is the preimage of this. Okay, so now we sort of unwind the movie back in time. These two things here move back here. And I just keep this path, and I track it around, and it goes like this. Okay? So in my original fiber, I just move it back. The vanishing cycle will be the pre-image of this path here in the Z2 plane. By the way, this is the Z2 path, Z2 plane. This is Z2. And remember, there's a hole in the middle. Z2 cannot be 0. So you can't just say that it's this path here. Okay, so very good. And so by the way, this idea here with this short path and the pre-image of the short path is actually in Lefschetz's book. Topology and l'analyse situe c'est la géométrie algébrique. Topology and algebraic geometry. Okay, so. Yes, Lefschetz used Mathematica, yes. You know, in a mechanical form with gears. Right.
French, is that true?
Was that?
Did Lefschetz write in French?
Of course, he was trained in Russia. And I assume that he, at least at that time, later he wrote, when he was at Princeton, I think he wrote in English. But at that time, yeah. So, similarly, so we get this base. Now I'm going to be slightly, so you know, there's a sort of symmetry between various roots of unity, and you get these guys here. Okay, orange. Yellow. And hot pink. There you go. Okay? All right. So these are the vanishing cycles. Now brought together all the same fiber, which is the Z2 plane at C equals 0. Okay. Now let's see what the intersections are. Okay. So let's look at, you know, hot pink and orange. They have one point here in common. There's one intersection point. And they have another whole fiber in common. So they both pre-images of that fiber are intersection points. So it's 1 plus 2, it's actually equal to 3. You sweat a little bit with signs. And so then, indeed, okay, which is the prediction. It's supposed to be 3 choose 1 and 3 choose 2, okay, which is both 3. Right. So it's a great success. So let's go up one dimension. Okay. So you'll notice that the numbers that entered into getting these threes were 1, 2. Okay, so let's look at this. So I'm using the same strategy, right? So okay. So so what happens, this thing here, so this is itself is not a branch cover, right? Wrong dimension. Algebraic surface. So this has fibers which are Riemann surfaces. This itself has, four non-degenerate singularities. Okay, so, sorry, the Z3 plane. So here's the Z3 plane, say for C equals to zero. There's a hole in the middle, and there are four points. So these are the critical values of Z3, okay? And so on top of this, it's this algebraic surface here. Okay? The same thing happens as before, which is if I now, if instead of saying equals to zero, I say equals to C, right? Then, I change C here and I turn on Mathematica and the critical values move around. And if you choose C to be close to one of the critical values of the original map I, two of those will collide, almost collide, okay? So again, when you follow this movie backwards like we've done, you can draw certain paths here. Which turn out to be these paths here. Okay? What do those paths actually mean, right? Remember, in here, we're expecting a vanishing cycle, which is a two-sphere in this case here. This is algebraic surface, it's a four-dimensional manifold. Okay? So what does the purple two-sphere have to do with the purple path? Well, so by definition, there is a there are two critical points, so these are critical points of the map Z3, okay? That one that lies in this fiber and that fiber, okay? And so out of that critical point, if you follow this path here, out of that critical point comes a Lefschetz thimble for Z3, which sort of becomes bigger, and then miraculously it actually joins up with the other Lefschetz thimble for this and gets smaller again. So roughly speaking, it's not exactly correct, but roughly speaking, this sphere here is fiber path here. Okay, and in every fiber, it's a vanishing cycle. It's a vanishing cycle for Z3, original thing. Okay. So if we could understand, so basically, if you want to know how these vanishing cycles intersect, which is what we're trying to compute, what you have to look at is, as before, you have to look at these paths. Well, sometimes these paths have a common endpoint, that's good. They will give you one intersection point. And then there's a certain number of intersection points that happen right here. Okay? And before that, What I said in the low-dimensional situation is, well, we had a 2-to-1 branch cover, so the five, you know, over this there are 2 points, there are 2 intersection points. Okay, but now we're screwed, because over here there is actually a Riemann surface. In that surface there are certain paths, and how often those paths intersect that will determine what the contribution here is. Okay. Okay. So generally speaking, this is not an unsolvable problem, but it's somewhat harder. Okay. But however, in this particular case here, there is a miracle. Okay. So let's look where we're trying to do this computation here. So, okay, so I want to look at the fiber of this guy here. So, okay, excuse me. So it's this guy here. Let's suppose, for simplicity, we're just looking at this fiber at zero. And moreover, I want to look at a fixed value of z3. So I'm somewhere here in the z3 plane. Fixed. Okay. So now, so z3 is supposed to be non-zero. So, and let me change coordinates. Okay, so I have z1 and z2 coordinates, and I'm going to change them like this. Okay. So let's just multiplying them with some root, which I can because I've wrote z3 as e to the t. Okay. So then what we get is e to the minus t over 3 z1 tilde plus e to the minus t over 3 z2 tilde plus 1 over z1 tilde z2 tilde. Well, there is e to the minus t here, and there'll be some partial cancellation going on. So it actually gets you e to the minus e over 3. And, you know, I forgot this term here. That's what you think, but actually I did. Okay? So this is this. Which is also equal to z1 tilde plus z2 tilde plus, okay, 1 over z1 tilde z2 tilde is equal minus e to the, the sign isn't really important, 4/3 t. I hope you all agree. Okay? So this guy here is the fiber of the function one dimension down with one less variable, except at some strange point. Okay? So, in other words, we take our original. So, this was our problem here, was to take this guy here. Thank you. map to this here. Okay, and this is a low dimensional problem, which is Z1 tilde plus Z2 tilde, which is C star squared, mapping to C by, Z1 tilde plus Z2 tilde plus 1 over Z1 tilde Z2 tilde. And here we have the same thing. And so here we have the pullback by whatever we did here, minus e to the 4/3 t, okay? So this same thing means that's the same thing in both cases, okay? And in fact, but that one here actually is a bit strange. It doesn't actually hit the value zero ever, so you're not pulling back by covering or something. There's a hole here in the middle. And here, it's the pullback by, so pullback means, you know, you do a base extension here, pullback by e to the t. So I set z3 equals e to the t. Okay, so they are, this is the thing we wanted to look at to solve the problem of symbols here, and this is the thing that we already essentially know everything about, okay? So except there's this strange parameter change. So if I okay, so this guy here, we know it has three critical points at 3 times cube root of unity. This guy here has 4 critical points, and it also has a hole in the middle. Okay, those are the basis of all those three things. So it seems sort of unlikely that there would be a relation between the two because of the 4 equals 3 problem. Okay, so here we of course have infinitely many. Because of the periodicity of the exponential map. Okay, so now let's see. So I take this guy here. Okay, so this guy here, let me draw him as in a slightly better way, like this, okay? So let's see what he's doing. You start at this point, let's say, okay? You go inside, then you pass one other critical point on your right, you pass another one on your right, and then you arrive here. By the way, I should say that these things do not have preferred orientations, right? So this is just for instructional purposes. So what does a pre-map guy here look like? Well, going inside means under log going down. I pass 2 and I go up here. Okay? Or of course I could do this guy here. Okay? And what happens when I project down to here? Well, so the projection here doesn't hit zero, right? Okay? So I do the same thing down here, right? This is 4/3 t. Okay, so I start somewhere, I go in, I pass 1, I pass the other one, and then I go back here. Okay, so this is actually, maybe I should just, I'm not really sure. Okay. This second thing here was a pre-image under this projection here, right? If you take, so this, what happens with, why does it self-intersect here, right? It didn't self-intersect there. Well, you know, this is a lift of that. If you take the next lift, it will start right here, because there's three of them, so it's actually an intersection between two different lifts. So, you know, as far as that self-intersection, if we wanted to understand this guy here, we're not actually interested. Okay? So now I take the next guy. Oh, let me take the opposite guy for more clarity. So it's this guy here, okay? So that would be equal to that guy here, okay? And under projection, it goes to maybe this guy here. Okay? So if I want to understand the intersections of these two things, I have to look at all the pre-images of, say, the purple one up here. Okay? And so if I project, well, let me draw this purple hashed. Okay. And if I project the purple hashed down to this guy here, it is actually okay. So now I have to look at all the intersections between the purples, hashed or not, and the yellow one. Okay? So now here, what's the point here? So I understand the situation here completely because, you know, in this guy here and that guy here, how do they intersect in this fiber? Well, that was the problem that we previously solved. Right, the intersection number is 3. So basically, in each of those 4 points, you get 3 when it comes to the intersection number. Now, if you think about it carefully, you'll see that this can't quite be the case because 2 points where it intersects, and 2 is not 4. So what happens is, you know, 2 of those points actually lift, one of these and one of that, and the other 2 belong to different lifts. So you're sort of repeating yourself. Okay, so the intersection number here is 3 plus 3 equals to 6. Okay, so you get 2 points that contribute here, and this is a computation by induction on dimension. So indeed, if say these guys here are the left symbols for this function here. So, z1 plus and so on. One tilde plus. So for the problem 1 dimension down, and as I should have tilde, and delta 1, delta n plus 1, are the left shift symbols for the actual problem 1 dimension up, then what happens is that these guys here for I less than j is equal to okay. So you take 2 of those and you add them up. Okay, so that's in fact that gives you Pascal's triangle, and that explains the n plus 1 choose j minus I formula. Okay, yes.
So somehow we must use the
okay. Yeah. Let's first. Here, the elementary, is there an elementary question about how this proceeded? Okay, so in order to prove the theorem about homology classes of Lefschetz symbols, you have to do this, a sort of souped up version of this using actual symplectic topology. It's, you know, in this paper. Some of the intermediate steps are still so the question is, what are we actually doing? Why can we do it by induction on dimension? Okay, that's Mohammed's question. Okay, that's grown-up question. Well, one possible answer of this is the following thing. There is a construction of Kuznetsov, Okay, the construction says the following thing. And this is true for projective space. Suppose that you have some kind of collection of exceptional objects, some properties, corresponds to a basis. And the last object is equal to the first one, tensored with some line bundle. And you take a divisor in the linear system corresponding to that line bundle. Then you can drop the last object, restrict the other ones, and you get an exceptional collection on the divisor, and there is a certain property that comes up having to do with the acts between those objects. Now, that is that is all very nice, but in fact, that's not exactly what's happening here. Okay, so what's happening here is that there are intermediate objects, which are these fibrations here. I'm not 100% sure what the proper interpretation of those is.
But that total space is mirrored to the anti-canonical.
That total space is mirrored to a singular anti-canonical divisor. So this category here that you see here is slightly larger than the singular anti-canonical divisor, and I believe it has something to do with the anti-canonical divisor. In this case here is just the divisor in projective space where you set one or more coordinates equals to zero. And fundamentally, I believe that it has to do with the case that if you take the cone over that one, the extension has something to do with all of D-brains. And I believe that the fundamental thing is here that if you take the cone over that one, you get the corresponding divisor in projective space one dimension higher. But there's a question is, why is this inductive procedure successful? Why would you care? Okay. Well, you would care because the question is there other examples? There are Laurent polynomials associated to arbitrary polytopes. What's the condition on the polytope that would allow me to do, let's say, one step of an inductive computation? I think that's an interesting question. All right. Thank you very much.